ending. The background to the story is that Elijah, the prophet of Israel, is on the run after having offended King Ahab and his wife Jezebel with his straight talking. The biblical book rates the performance of the kings of Israel, and King Ahab has a woeful report. It says he is worse than his predecessors. So we can understand that the prophet had his work cut out, seeing if he could influence Ahab for the better. In our story, we hear that the whole region is in the throes of severe drought. But so far, Elijah has fared well. He's camped by a stream, and it says the ravens feed him breakfast and supper. But then the stream dried up, and Elijah had to leave his sanctuary and wander further into the dry foreign territory. Now we have all seen the effects of drought in both our countries and especially in places like Sudan, Somalia, and in the Middle East, where streams of people and animals have had to leave to survive. Those left behind would be either too young or old or weak for the journey. And they lived in the hope that family members would return with food. Now, our story today tells of a widow who we hear is in a desperate situation, eking out her provisions to the last teaspoonful. And Elijah arrives, starving, and asks her to share her food. Now, presumably, others over the weeks and months of the drought had passed by as well and asked her for food. And in doing so, have helped to deplete her provisions to this stage. We are told that her situation is hopeless. She says, I've only enough for my son and myself, and then I'll die. But the story is written as if God is whispering into Elijah's ear that everything will be all right. You know, it's like reading a book and starting at the end. Or being told the football score before you've actually watched the game. It masks the desperation of the life and death situation of the Lord. However, if we consider what it might have been like for the two characters, we find Elijah on one hand trusting his experience of God and in the conviction of his calling, but he lands at the woman's door with a price on his head, without food, water, or shelter in a drought-stricken area. And on the other hand, we have the widow explaining to the stranger exactly what the cost will be to her if she shares any food. That's going to be the much earlier death of her son and herself. She's not really prepared to jeopardize her life and that of her son further. Yet in their conversation, Elijah convinces her that sharing is their last and only hope. And she risked it. And we hear, utterly unexpectedly, she discovered that her jars of oil and grain had become bottomless, feeding herself, her family, and Elijah for the rest of the drought. And being a woman of hospitality, it probably stretched to others as well. This is a great story for we golden girls today. Josephine tradition of relying on the providence of God. Because we've often worked without regular incomes, we've relied on others, our congregation, our family, our friends, and parishioners, to share with us. When we were young, the old sisters would tell stories about the really lean times that they had, with no food in the cupboards. And they prayed, they said. And sure enough, someone would come to the door with potatoes or vegetables from the garden. Or they'd need eggs. And they'd put their last egg in front of the statue of St. Joseph. And as you'll appreciate, there were some very lean times where waiting and waiting on providence was part of the deal. We attribute this extraordinary generosity to sharing in God's providence. Now, please don't think we're going to take up a collection now. At our mature age, we are receiving the government's contribution to our But after 50 years of experiencing providence, we have three little insights to share today. And the first is that providence is surprising. Providing, just as the widow was finding she hadn't reached the last drop of oil. And our challenge is to be attentive to these surprises, not to take them for granted, and certainly never to feel that owed to us. This surprising providence has released joy and great gratitude in us. Now, a second little insight, that providence has stretched us. For us, we found we've experienced providence. We feel challenged to participate with God in providing. We have a saying, never see an evil without doing something about it. And so we kind of feel compelled to advocate for asylum seekers, for trafficked humans, for peace, for social justice, for inclusion and reconciliation in our communities and our world. For us, it's mainly ministering in ordinary little ways, sharing our resources, our education, our spirituality, our lives. And it calls us to be open, to learn and understand, and to be influenced by those who understand and do it much better than we do. And especially in this time, we're being stretched to recognize God's providence in all creation. As Pope Francis has said, Earth is the common home of people, of animals and plants, of all life. So we're stretched to change our practices, to reverence other forms of life, and such things as refrain from destroying their habitat. Over our 50 years, we've had many opportunities to learn, to change, to receive, and to give. And our third little insight. Providence has many faces. this last week, we've shared lots of memories together that have inspired and sustained us over the years. And they've all been about kindness, understanding, straight talking, encouragement, and support. One sister told a little incident about when she was working in a part of the prison reserved for men with mental illnesses. And one of those men had killed three people while he was inside the prison. So although she had a rapport with him, she made sure she never had her back to him. Now one day, she said, the prison water main broke, and the mud and the slush began raining into the basement where these prisoners were housed. So she and the men worked really hard to shore up the area to prevent flooding. And she said, they'd just all finished, and she was standing there in all the mud, up to her elbows at least, when she felt a pull on her shoulder. And she turned around, and here was this prisoner with a little cap full of water. Sister, your hands are dirty. He said, let me wash them. The water was from the man's very meagre drinking supply, and he was offering it to her to wash her hands. We have all had such profoundly surprising generosity. And we must say that your presence with us today reinforces our confidence in Providence. You represent the multitude of sisters, families, friends, colleagues, and strangers who continue to be the face of God for us. Celebrating our Golden Jubilee is more than an individual milestone for us. We know for certainty it's a community milestone. Your support and encouragement in all its forms over these 50 years have kept us alert, inspired, and focused on our calling. And although we've scraped the bottom of the jar at times, today we celebrate God, generous providence, still welling with love, encouragement,